Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. No temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond your ability. But with the temptation, he will also provide the way of escape, that you may be able to endure it. This particular passage is not the most popular verse in the whole Bible, but it certainly has its place when it is applied to God's people from time to time. This text, and a handful like it, can really affect us. But in many ways, it depends upon the circumstance upon which we hear it. Obviously, these words are meant to be both a warning and a comfort. They warn that temptation is very real, and it will come to God's people. The devil is not going to leave us alone, even though we don't belong to him. He doesn't like us. He wants us to feel his wrath. But with temptation and trial will also come God's faithfulness and the endurance of the saints. The Lord seems to be saying that when those hard times come, all is well, even though it may not feel it, because God is not going to give us more than we can bear. That's pretty simple, isn't it? There will be cross and trial, but we will be able to bear it. The only problem is, it doesn't always seem that simple. Have you ever been in a temptation or a trial that just seems like it's all too much to bear? Maybe in those times you've actually heard this verse before, but somehow maybe it just didn't seem to make as much sense in those moments. Sometimes the world feels like it is caving in on us, surrounding us on all sides. There are consequences for our sins. Maybe we find ourselves in circumstances that we didn't ask for, circumstances that are beyond our control. We find ourselves in a situation we never, ever wanted to be in. And there is a great burden in those times. Sometimes it feels like it is so heavy, it is going to just crush us. But aren't we supposed to be able to bear it? Are we not supposed to be able to have the strength to endure, as the Word of God declares? If that's the case, well, why does it feel so hopeless sometimes? Why does it feel like we are so helpless? Where is God when I am being crushed? And why can't I lift this burden as he says I should? If any of us have been in this kind of situation before, or if you find yourself in this situation someday, we are not alone. Many of our brothers and sisters in Christ have felt the same way. They have wondered the same thoughts. That's why the scriptures today declare very simply, no temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. The obvious implication is that the temptations we face, the trials that we must endure, have been faced by others before us. The Apostle Paul today gives several examples, just a few of such temptation. He says, do not be idolaters, as some of them were, as it is written. The people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. The incident to which he refers is the idolatry that took place at Mount Sinai and the sinful revelry that followed. God had brought his people out of Egypt with a mighty outstretched hand. Pharaoh's army had been drowned in the Red Sea, and everyone was safe at last. But the people were not content. When Moses was called up the mountain to receive instruction from God, the people were supposed to wait until the appointed time when Moses would come and reveal the Lord's word to them. They were supposed to trust the Lord and be patient. But sinners don't like to wait. And they really, really don't like to be patient. It's kind of why, you know, if you ever notice parents with young children, they have to continue telling them over and over and over again, be patient, just wait. Maybe you've had that kind of experience yourself. But as it turns out, there's kind of a little impatient child in all of our hearts. Same thing happened to the Israelites. Many of them did not want to wait any longer, so they made themselves their own God. They worshiped the golden calf, believing it was God, and they thought it would comfort them and lead them. They took matters into their own hands and tried to overcome their temptations by their own works. But they just made a ruin of everything. Their false victory descended into unholy eating, drinking, and play. They made their hearts happy in the midst of temptation, but they were deceived by their own hands. And God was not pleased. Nor would God be pleased when the Israelites journeyed through the remainder of the wilderness. St. Paul recounts how they grumbled against the Lord. That was a pretty common problem for them. They grew tired of God's provision with the manna and the quail. They loathed the heat and the desert of the wilderness. They were afraid of entering the promised land because of the wicked inhabitants. They wished everything was just a little different. Their hearts longed for something more, something they thought was better. And so they complained against Moses and Aaron for all the trials that they had come to face. They felt crushed by the journey they had endured, and they desired only rest from their labors in the body. Anger, frustration, despair was in their hearts. And they lashed out at Moses so they could lash out against the Lord. And once again, sin had done its work. St. Paul goes on right after these recollections to say this. Let anyone who thinks that he stands take heed lest he fall. Those examples just given are of those who were tempted and who had fallen. These were those in days of old whose burdens were heavy and whose journeys were long. It was a difficult life, and sin was crouching at their door. The warning is very simple. Everyone can be crushed by the fallen world and the wickedness of the sinful flesh. If we think that we can endure all things on our own, we are gravely mistaken. We are sinful after all, and our flesh loves to sin. So how is it? How is it that the Word of God can so simply declare today, God will not let you be tempted beyond your ability? And that with the way of escape, you may be able to endure it. The lives of those who were tempted in the wilderness didn't always end well. And the burdens we carry sometimes make it feel like we are being crushed. Like we can't bear it anymore. Like escape no longer seems so imminent. What are we Christians supposed to do in such times? And in those times, what are we supposed to do when we hear these very words? We can't fix our problems. We can't carry all of our burdens, and left to the old man, we would perish. But that's not what God wants. That's not even his promise for us. For St. Paul says that the Christian will endure. And even in the midst of this, he says something that actually enlightens us about not only this whole passage, but how we see our whole lives. He says, very simply, but most profoundly, God is faithful. God is faithful. The Lord knows that we sinners cannot endure on our own. We can't triumph over our sins. We can't conquer all of our burdens. And we cannot ultimately defeat death. If we could do all these things, well, he wouldn't need to help us, would he? But he does need to help us. He needs to send Christ into the world to triumph over sin, death, and the devil. God is first and foremost faithful. When it comes to the crosses and the trials of life, When it comes to the burdens of a sinful world, this is actually where God shows and demonstrates his faithfulness to us in Christ Jesus our Lord. Though we would be crushed by the weight of all these things, God has chosen to crush his Son in our place. He sends him to be the one who must contend with the devil without any help. He sends him to bear sin as one who must ultimately pay for it. Jesus comes to suffer and to be crushed under the weight of a sinful world and the guilt of our sinful flesh. When you think about it, in Jesus, we actually see ourselves without the help of God, judged as guilty and sinful by the Lord and deserving the sentence of death. The good news is, however, there is hope, not despair. There is the resurrection and the triumph over the world and the sinful flesh. The crosses, the trials, and the sins that Jesus bore were not too much for him, for he has endured them all. It is with this faithfulness and this triumph in Christ that Paul says, God will not let you be tempted beyond your ability, and he will provide the way of escape that you may be able to endure it. Paul is not speaking about the old you, the sinful flesh that thinks it must find its own way in the world. It must take care of itself. It must save itself. He is speaking about the new in Christ. God will not let you be tempted beyond your ability. But the ability to which God speaks really is to his own faithfulness and righteousness manifested to you in Christ. The promise is that God sustains his people, not that you sustain yourself. When you hear these words in times of temptation and trial, they are a reminder that God will provide. He will provide a way out. In fact, he already has in his Son, Jesus Christ. The old Adam, though, when he hears these words, what he wants you to think is that God wants you to do the work. God wants you to take care of yourself. But that's a lie. That is the devil's lie. God wanted his people to wait for him at Mount Sinai. He wanted them to trust him, that he would give the manna and the quail and that it was enough. When the people of Israel came to the promised land, he wanted them to trust that God was going to take care of the inhabitants in the land. And you know what? God was faithful. They were never on their own, even though they thought they were. The old man was just trying to convince them that they had to do it by themselves. But the whole time, God was faithful in everything. That's why God can say that when those hard times come in your life, you will be able to endure. Because whatever you face, you do not face it alone. The Lord is with you, and he will get you through. I know that sometimes it doesn't feel that way, but that's just the devil. That's just the devil. He's trying to lie to you. He's trying to deceive you. He wants your old Adam to think differently. Whatever crosses and trials you face, the way of escape has already been provided. Jesus has died for your sins. Those sins of anger and doubt, the sins of idolatry and gluttony, those sins that make you despair of the very goodness and faithfulness of God and want you to trust in yourself. There is nothing else that God has not done for you in Christ. So that when you are burdened, when you are hurting, you may know that the trial will come to an end. Maybe sooner, maybe later, but it will come to an end because your forgiveness grants you heaven, where there will be no more sorrow, no more suffering, and no more sin. When the burdens are heavy and the journey is long, That is your hope. That resurrection is your victory in Christ. And the end of your life is going to be the resurrection. And of that hope, there will be no end forever. In the name of Jesus, amen. And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.